Welcome back, everybody. In the last part of today's lecture, we were talking about increasing the size of the array. So we have declared an other array of the pointer type percentage static q. So we have declared it of the size 10. Previous array was of size 5. So we have copied the values of the dynamic array p to dynamic array q, and then we have freed up the pointer for the array p. So, and we have stored the address of the bigger array, that is basically q, that is of size 10, into the array p. So we have stored the new address into the array p, and now this is the size of the array p. Dynamic array p is increased, that is basically 10 now. And then we have initialized this address of the array q equal to null, so it is not pointing anywhere. So this is how we have increased the size of the array. So next topic is the two dimensional arrays. So up till now we were discussing the one dimensional array. So basically the two dimensional array comes from the concept you have already seen in the case of matrix and the tables. So in the case of tables, we have the rows as well as columns. So that is basically one of the very good examples for the two dimensional. So two dimensional array m into n is the collection of m comma n m dot n and data elements, such as each element is specified by the pair of integers j comma k, that are called subscripts. So each row and column is basically specified by the pair of integers. So this is representing the row and this is representing the column. So their values are basically between 0 to m. M is representing rows, the value of j is between 0 to m, and in case of column, it is between 0 to n. That is basically the size of the array. So next, the arrays, two dimensional arrays, can be the row measured or the column measured. What do you mean by the row measured or the column measured? Basically, first row, first column, second row, first column, and third row, first column. This is basically we are dealing in terms of the column. So this is the column measured. So here it is row measured. First row, first column, first row, second column, first row, third column, first row, fourth column. Basically, we are dealing with the these two types of two ways of representing the memory. In the memory, we can represent it in the column measured or the row measured. So representation depends upon the programming language used. So it depends on the programming language. So column 1, column 2, column 3, column measured, and the row measured. So how we can calculate the address in the 2-day array location? So basically, this is the formula for base of A, address of an array, basically the starting address of an array. Let me close this. And then W is equal to the size of the element, and M is the total number of rows, N is the total number of columns, J and K is representing the current row and column of the target is targeted position for finding the address. So at this row and column, we want to find the address. So here is the example. So we have 2D array. We want to find the 25. The size of the array is basically 25 into 4, 25 rows and 4 columns. So W is equal to 4. Here this W, basically size of the element. It is 4 bytes, and the base address, we must know the base address, and M is the row number and N is the column number. So if I want to find the location of the 12th row and the third column, address of the 12th row and the third column element. So just we have to put these values, base address and the width and the total number of rows, total number of columns in these formulas. If it is column measured, we have to apply this formula, and if it is row measured, then we have to apply this formula. So here row minus this thing, and here is the column minus this thing. So this is how we can find the address. So examples of 2D arrays. Basically, we can allocate the memory for the 2D arrays in three different methods. First method is to allocate it into the stack memory. Here we have seen the different types of memories. One is to allocate it into the stack memory, one method. Second method is allocate rows in the stack memory and columns into the heap, and the third is to allocate both rows and columns into the heap. These are the three different ways of basically allocating the memories for the 2D array. So 2D array in stack, rows in stack and columns in the heap, and both rows and columns in the heap. So these are this is the simple, you have already seen 3 into 4. So here three rows, one row, second row, third row, and one column, second column, third column, fourth column. 3 into 4 column arrays created by using this method. This is the simple method that we are usually used to create the array in the stack. And then by using single pointer, in this case, rows in the stack and column in the heap, using single pointer. By using double pointer, both the row and columns are created in the heap by using this syntax. So here we are using double pointer in this case. So all other syntax is same. So these are the different ways to create 2D array in the memory. So what can be the problems in the case of arrays? Capacity cannot change during program execution. This we have already discussed. Memory can be waste. For example, if we have created a memory of very big size during the allocation of the arrays, so memory can be wasted. And what else? Out of range errors. So some kinds, if we have allocated the memory of the small size, so it can give the out of range errors. Arrays are not self-contained object, no way to find last value stored. So we cannot find as they are not self-contained objects, so there is no way to find the last value stored. So what is the last value stored? So these are some of the problems that are faced in the array data structure. Okay, what is the array ADT? ADT, as we have already discussed, that stands for abstract data type. So we are in this part of the lecture, we will discuss how ADT is different from the simple data structures. So ADT, as we know from the name, that is basically the. So what do we mean by the this? A data structure is the physical implementation. Remember this. This is the physical implementation of an ADT. ADT have the physical implementation in the form of a data structure. Each operation associated with the ADT is implemented by one or more subroutines in the implementation. So one or more subroutines are used for the implementation of that. So each operation associated with the ADT is implemented by one or more subroutines in the implementation. So data structure usually refers to the organization of data in the memory. So it refers to the organization of data in the memory. And same like in case of file structure, as we know that is the organization of data on the peripheral storage such as disk drive. So let's see. Here you will more understand about the abstract data type. What do we mean? A definition for an ADT solely in terms of the representation and the set of operations on the data. How is the representation of the data and the set of operations that we can perform on the data? Each ADT operation is defined by its input and the output. So let's see. Data representation, it is in the form of array space, size, length, or the number of elements. So this is this we mean by the data representation. By the data operations, we means display function, how we can display the elements, how we can add the elements or append the element in the array, and how we can insert the element, how we can delete the element by the particular index, how we can search the particular element and finding the max and min, and getting any value, setting any value based on the index, reversing, shifting, and rotating. These are different data operations which we can perform in ADT. So basically, encapsulation combines the data and function in a single entity to hide implementation details. So this is basically for hiding the implementation detail. This concept you have already studied in the OOP, object oriented programming. That definition of the encapsulation, what do we mean by that? So another explanation for the abstract data type, basically a collection of the related data items together with an associated set of operations. In this case, we also have the associated set of operations. For example, I am giving the two examples from the daily life. In case of whole number integers, the arithmetic operator for these are the basically operations: addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. So in case of whole number, we can perform these simple arithmetic operations on them. From the daily life, I talk about the flight reservations. If I want to reserve any flight, so the basic operation that I need to perform, I have to check the empty seat, whether it is available or not. I have to reserve a seat or cancel a seat assignment. So these are the different operations that I need to know for the flight reservation. So why abstract? Why we have given the name abstract? Basically, data operations and relations are studied independent of implementation. So here we are not talking in detail about the implementation in case of the abstract data type. This is the major difference between both the ADT and the data structure. So next, the another representation for finding the difference between the ADT and the data structure. In the case of ADT, it is the type operations and data items are in logical form. They are in logical form, and in case of data structures, it comes from the ADT, basically storage space and subroutines. So here we are dealing with the storage space and subroutines, and data items are represented in the physical form. So here we are more concerned with the types and operation in the logical form. Here we are more concerned about the storage space and subroutines in the physical form. So this is the difference between both of them. So some of the examples of the ADT abstract data type: display an array. So how we can display the array? For example, here we have initialized the array of the structure type. So it is of type integer. We have declared it of pointer type. So int size, int length. So here we have declared the structure type array. So basically I want to display the array. So here we are basically defining the function of the display type. So I am calling this structure with the name ARR. So if I want to display the elements, so basically elements are here we are basically printing it. So by using for loop, it is starting from 0 going up to the length of the array. So I plus plus, so here we are basically displaying elements of the array. So here we are using the simple AR. We are not making any changes in the array or structure, so that's why we haven't taken the pointer variable. So we are just using the dot operator to display the elements in the array A of I. So you can see int main structure A double R array A double R. So int n, so print the size of the array. We are taking basically enter the size of the array. We are taking the array of this size. Basically it is taking the value from the user and allocating dynamic memory based on the size entered by the user, and then we have initialized the length equal to 0. Enter the number of numbers, so how many numbers the numbers that we want to enter in that array. So enter all the elements. So here we are entering the elements. It will by using for loop, so it will take the elements and store it, and then here we have called the display function. This program is simply taking the input from the user and displaying it by using the concept of ADT. So this is another program for displaying. Here we have taken the array of size 20. So this is how you can check it. So if you have any problems, you can discuss with me, or you can send me the message through email. So next, appending and inserting in an array. So if I want to append the array, or if I want to insert the element into the array, so how we can do it? Basically, before just we were displaying the values, we were not making any changes. Now we are making changes in the array. For this, we need, for accessing structure using pointer. For this, we need to access the structure using pointer. So for making the changes, you will see here we are using the pointer. So you can see we can do it by using this way, by using the arrow, p arrow length equal to 5, or we can do it by using p dot length equal to 5. So this is the way for accessing structure using pointer. So we will be using this. So same way, display and the append and the insert, these are the different function that we are creating in this program. Basically this is the main of our program. So you can see if I want to insert any element, this is how we can insert the element in the array. So here we have taken the ARR1 array with these elements, and this is the size of the array, and the length of the array is 5. Basically, remember the difference between the size and the length. Size is the complete size of the array, and the length is the number of elements present in that array. So it is 5. So this is the length and this is the size. So I want to display the elements. So this is the function for displaying. So this is the commonly used function that we have already seen in the previous slides as well. So you can see it, just it is a displaying the elements in the array. basically that is of length L, and that is basically of this length. Appending the array, as we want to make include add the element at the end of the array, so it would be at the I want to include this element. So talk about this append array, so I want to include 10 at the end of the length of this array, so 10 would be included here. So first we have to check whether is it possible to append the array or not, because if this condition is not satisfied, we cannot append the array. The length should be less than size, so length should be less than size. If it is equal or if it is greater, then it would not be possible. So length of the array should be less than the size of the array, then we can include the element in the array. If it is not this condition is not satisfied, then appending is not possible. We have checked. So by using this pointer kind of structure for accessing structure using array, we have used the pointer. So array in this we have checked this condition. So a double R structure, we are checking the length is less than the size of that. Next, insert. If I want to insert the any element in the array, I must know the index where I want to insert, and then the element that I want to insert. So this is the same as we are making the changes in the array. So we are using the steric. So similarly, we have to check the condition that the index should be greater than 0, and the index should be less than or equal to the length. So we have to check this condition. So what we will do in case of insertion, basically we will check that from the length we will start, and we will check that I is greater than index I minus minus. This is the loop that in which basically we will use to insert any element. For example, I want to insert this element at this index x, so basically it will move all the elements at this position. So in this case length is 5. So if I want to for example, if I want to insert here, so it will move all the elements to one step forward, so then it will be empty and here the element would be inserted. So this is how basically the value of I would be the length 5. So it will store the I equal to 5. So what it will do, it will store I minus 1, 5 minus 1, basically 5 minus 1 would be this 4 index, so it will move into the index 5. So similarly it will move up till this condition. So all these elements will move to the next position, and this place would be empty, and it will store the a of index is equal to x, and then we will increase the length of the array by one size, as we have inserted one more element in the array. So similarly, this is the main from where we are calling the function. Next, if I want to delete the any element from the array, so let me clear. Okay, so this is the basically the function for deletion of any element. For this, we have to give the index from where I want to delete the element. Basically, we are making the changes. So here we are using the pointer. And then int x is equal to 0 and I. So I want to check the condition whether this condition is satisfied, then it would be possible to delete that particular element from there. And that what is the condition? Basically, the index should be greater than 0 and the index should be the less than the length. So as we can see, it should be less than this length. It should lie within this area, not in this area. So we have to check this condition. So basically, we are in x, we are storing the a of index. Then I is equal to index, and I is less than length minus 1. So, and I plus plus. So basically, this is how it will check this condition and store the values. First, it will delete the value and then move the values from the next position to the space where it is, from where the value is deleted. So if I am deleting this value, so all of these element will be moved to the previous position. So this is how it is doing, and the length is decreased to one size. So in case of insertion, we were increasing the length plus plus at the end. In case of deletion, where we have decreased the length because we have decreased to one element. So this is how we are decreasing by using ADT. So next is the linear search. So this is basically your home task. You can see it. This is also very simple. We can perform the linear search by using array. So this is all for today's lecture. Hopefully you will understand it. So in the next lecture, we will discuss the next topic. So thank you.